Well, hello there again, my YouTube friends. On the bench tonight, I've decided to put together a little step-down power supply kit, which I've had lying around for quite a long time now, so I thought I'd put it together and bring you guys along with me. So this is just it's actually a dual input power supply. It can run on AC or DC on the input. DC has the most variable sort of voltage, which goes from 5 volt to 35 volts, but it can also run off AC between 6 and 25 volts, I believe. It will output DC at between 1 and 30 volts, which is quite a good range, especially for hobbyists who want to, you know, use that sort of voltage range. Also, it's got a little potentiometer, so it's adjustable via the LM317, which is an adjustable regulator. And it comes with what's this little fella? He is a, can you see, can you not see? Now you can see. Oop, 5551. So he's a NPN transistor. Comes with just basically the things you can see here. There's only a few little bits to put together on it. One thing I did notice was when I got the kit, this is the first time it's been opened, or sort of the bag's been opened anyway. This little terminal block here doesn't have any screws with it, which would have been handy. The PCB's drilled a bit weird, as you can see there, because the holes don't really line up too good. Unless you're supposed to cut those two little cutouts there, but I don't think so. I think that's what they're for. But I mean, they seem to line up better. Oh, they seem to line, or would line up better, if the thing was cut out of the end of that board. But I don't suppose it matters. I think what I'll do is we'll obviously have to check which one's positive and negative first. But I think I'll probably put it like that, as long as it's not in the way of anything. Maybe slightly lower down like that. The holes do line up through there as well, so it will work like that. And that's not blocking any components on this side of the board, so probably end up going like that. But yeah, that's the kit and everything. There's no instructions with it. You just get the, on the sort of top of the PCB, it's all sort of stamped on. Where you're supposed to put all the little components. So pretty straightforward. So I'll put this together, and what we'll do is we'll test it at the end and see if it lives up to its specs. So I think first off I'll start with my little LM317, and what I'll do is I think I'll bend the pins as I go along, just make sure first these things fit into the holes on the PCB without needing any modification, which they do. Don't do. Just a tiny little bit of that on there. It's not, I don't really do that normally with some of these kits. You know, as long as you've got a good sort of face fit between the two surfaces, you'll get, you know, a good contact. Now, is that screw for the transistor? He's going in at an angle, guys. So, see if I can catch the thread again. Yep. And I'll just leave that loose on there so we can put it through this board. Put the legs through first on the transistor, and then the heat sink through the back like that. And then what I'll do is I'll tighten this screw up, and it'll help hold it in the board. Sometimes it doesn't, it just depends how the you know, the legs are bent on the back of the transistor. I mean, sometimes they're bent all over the place like that. So you have to straighten them all out first. So I can get away with that like that. Next up, I'll do... So if I do some smaller components there, that's probably good. So we've got one LED, which goes... It hasn't actually got the little shape. I always look for the shape on the LED because a lot of people, they seem to look for the plus and the minus on the LED, which is all well and good. Now, quite often you get, you know, you, as a hobbyist, you'll get people who chop the legs off LEDs and they chop them off square. So you've no idea. You've got an idea. You can tell which one is the anode and cathode by the length of the leg. But if they're cut off equally, a lot of people get stuck. But what you can look for on the side of the LED, I don't know whether you're able to see it on the camera there, I'm just looking through now, there's a slight flat on one side, and that's the same on 99% of LEDs. There'll be a little flat, and that little flat is always the negative side or the cathode side. And quite often on the PCBs you'll have a little flat depicted on the silk screen or on the top of the PCB, so you know which one's which. So I mean, we have got the plus and the minus anyway, so there's no sort of real problem there. So we can just pop him through there like that, and then I always put them flat down. I don't leave them sticking out of the board about 3 feet like that. I always like to have them square down on the board depending on application. And we'll just part the pins of the legs a little bit there and have it sitting flat. I've started using these I'll just show you these little bobbins for my solder. I don't like having the whole reels knocking around on my bench here because they get a bit in the way. So all I've done is I've screwed three screws into the face of my wooden panel there. I'm not going to show you because the camera's in the right place, but they just sit on, you know, three screws, and when they run out I just re-reel them, and they last long enough, or plenty long enough, for, you know, what I need them for. So yeah, that's what I do with my solder, in case you want to. It just saves having these things, you know, lying all over the bench all the time, because I've got about seven of these different diameters and everything, so I like to keep them out the way. And that'll last me ages, and it's just, you know, that big of a thing on the bench there. And now our little potentiometer. Make sure you sat down nice and square. Just put plenty of solder around him to give him, you know, plenty of support. Hopefully without melting the bottom of the contact block. That's called painting with solder. So he will be hot for a while, but you can see it's down pretty good. But I think I can get him a little bit better. Yep, felt him snap down a little bit more. And I think, in fact, he can go down a tad more. Yep. Okay, guys, so a successful little build there. I've got no parts left, which is always a good sign. So we'll plug this little fella up now and see what he can do. First of all, I'll just get some little nuts or screws and bolts to fit this. Okay, so I found a couple of little screws. I don't like slot head screws. Never have. Always prefer the old Phillips variety. Now, if this was super important, I would put some either washers on there or Loctite. But as it's not super important, there's no need for the moment. So that's it done, guys. That's the completed little unit. He looks kind of neat, doesn't he? Okay, so we've got this little fella set up, and I've put a couple of wires on him here on the input, just so I can connect some DC and AC up to him. And I'm going to stick a couple of little terminals on, well, temporary terminals, as you'll see, like so. And I think also what I'll do is I'll put you guys on the other camera, and then just let me get a couple of little clips out here. We'll be able to see what's on the outputs. Like so. Okay, so first off, what I'm going to do for the test is I'm just going to turn my Keithley power supply up to 30 volts straight off, and its maximum output current, which is 1.5, just over 1.5 amps. So we'll go 30 volts, enter, current 1.55 amps, enter, and then we'll connect this up. And you'll be able to see on the other camera now what's going on. So we'll stick that on voltage. And first off on that, we'll stick that on half an amp. Okay, and we'll turn the power supply on. And he was left on full, which is no good. But at least it works. So I'll turn the power supply on. Okay, 30 volts, 1.5 amps. And I'll turn this little power supply on now. And he should be outputting, yep, 1.25 volts, as we can see there. So that's pretty good. At least he works. So we'll go up on the, we'll go up to about 5 volts now. He's quite fine with his control. You've got to be pretty fine with the little potentiometer here, but it's okay, you can get it near enough. So first off, it's supposed to be able to supply 1 amp. So what we'll do is we'll try him on half an amp first. Hang on, why have we got no output? Why have we got no output here? That's why, because I haven't connected the electronic load up. Flipping, eh? Getting old. Okay, so now we've got some output here. So we've got 5.1 on the electronic load as well. So we'll put a load on him of half an amp. And there we go. No problem at all. So we'll just make sure that he can take the full 1 amp and check that his voltage is in regulation or near enough, which is, that's 1 amp and he's still outputting just over 5 volts, so that's just fine. Let me just test the heatsink. Oof, the heatsink's getting quite hot. Wow, the heatsink's really hot. So that's one down point of that little power supply. He produces a lot of heat and could do, to be honest, with a better heatsink. So what I'm going to do is, if I can get this on camera as well, I will do. Okay, so let's put that in there like that and turn that on. Okay, so we can see there's no load on it at the moment, but that heatsink is still at 47 degrees. So let's turn the load back on. We'll probably see that increasing now. So as you can see, he's going up really high, really quick. So I'm going to turn that off. So if you're going to use this at 5 volts with its maximum current rating, you're going to need a larger heatsink or a fan on the heatsink. You can get 20 millimeter fans for computers, believe it or not, for little chips, etc. So you can get older than, but I would advise probably a bigger heatsink and maybe a fan also if you're going to use it at its maximum current. So the load's off. So now I'm going to, actually, I'm just going to wait for that heatsink to cool down a little bit as well.
Emission time. Time that stretch you've been wanting.
So he's still on. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to turn the output voltage up to, say, 12 volts. And just make sure he can hold his current reading at 12 volts. So there we are at 12. And we'll start off as half an amp again like we did before. And turn the load on. That's working just fine. 6.1 watts and not much of a drop in the voltage, but there is a small drop as we go up to 1 amp. He's still holding his voltage okay, so that's all right. Temperature is going to probably increase. Yeah, it's going well too high, so that the heatsink's no good really for the specified output. So just to be complete, we'll go up to its maximum output voltage, which we'll see what we get, 27.3 volts with a 30 volt input. And we'll go straight for 1 amp. I'm not going to leave this on long just in case the temperature goes over 70 odd degrees, but here we go. It might actually climb less the temperature once it's it's working at its full capability. So it's on pulling 1 amp. Now the voltage has dropped a little bit. Temperature is actually staying more stable now. In fact, it's dropping a little bit. Now it's on at its capacity. The regulator's having to work harder actually at lower voltage, so that's probably why the increase is so rapid at lower voltages. But it's working fine anyway. I'm not gonna, let's go to 1.3 volts. We are dropping down on the temperature a little bit, the voltage a little bit. But I mean, it will output. Oh, there it goes. So 1.4, 1.5 amps and it drops out. But that's only to be expected, so that's okay. Okay, so I'm just going to plug some AC into this now, and we'll see if he performs just as well. So I'll turn the variac on, and you'll have to trust me on this voltage, guys, because I'm reading it off the the other multimeter. So I've got him set to AC, and we'll turn this up to 25 volts, which is, that'll do, 25.4. Okay, so we turn this one back on. So he's on, and now we can watch the multimeter and the electronic load, and also the temperature. I've given him a minute or two to cool down a bit, so we'll see what sort of effect AC has on that little LM317. So let's go to, current, half an amp, and just set that as okay. And we can see straight away that it's outputting its 1.2 volt DC, which is perfectly fine. We'll start off like we did last time at 5 volts on the output. Which we'll do there, and we'll turn the load on. Probably see the temperature start to shoot up now. As the little 317 tries to regulate the voltage with a little piffling heatsink. So it's still staying regulated at half a amp. So just for completeness, we'll go up to 1 amp and turn him on again. And voltage is staying okay. Temperature's going up quite rapidly, so we'll turn that off. And we'll go straight up to the maximum output now with an AC input. We'll get 31.1 volts. I think we'll just go straight to 1 amp here. See if he can handle it. So we'll turn that on. And voltage drops down quite substantially. 4 volts, which is quite substantial at 1 amp. The temperature won't increase as dramatically once the LM317's got a little bit less to do. But he's fine up to, well, sort of fine up to about 400 milliamps to 500 milliamps. His voltage is nearly on, so I mean it's not going to be super accurate as a DC supply from AC, but it will do for hobby use if you haven't got a power supply, say. So it does work well, and it is functional. I'll just turn my variac off. I don't want any nasty shocks. Is it any good? Yeah, it's okay. And it's worth a buy. I think they're only about £5 or £6, these things. And for anyone who's not built a kit up before, it's quite an interesting little job for someone to do. It's not very difficult, just as long as you can do a little bit of soldering. So that's that, guys. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I shall see you in the next one. If you can remember to give us a thumbs up, it's always much appreciated. Okay. Thanks very much for watching, guys. Take care.